Okay. Hello, everyone. Please sit down. We want to get started. Okay, so today we're going to continue with the topic that we've already discussed the last two lectures, namely how to fit nonlinear models to supervised learning using kernels. And we've talked about this beautiful idea, the kernel trick, right? Just to bring everyone again up to the same page. The idea is to use linear models to fit nonlinear functions by considering nonlinear transformations into some potentially very high-dimensional space. But then work in that high-dimensional space only implicitly via the inner product in that space. And that's what kernels allowed us to do, right? And we've talked about this idea of the kernel trick, which is basically taking a linear algorithm, like linear regression or the perceptron or support vector machines, and reformulating it in some way so that it's expressed in a manner such that data points only appear in terms of inner products, and then just replacing those inner products with this function k that takes 2 points and is meant to compute the inner product in that transformed space. Okay, and so we've reviewed what are kernel functions, what are their basic properties, right? They must act as inner products in some transformed space, and that's where they derive their properties from, right? So that means they must be symmetric, and they also must be positive definite. And we've discussed these properties at length. And last lecture, we also talked about a bunch of examples of kernels, just to remind everyone, because we'll be talking about them again today. So we had started originally with the linear kernel, the obvious one, which is just the inner product in the original feature space. That was the basis for talking about the polynomial kernel, which we talked about 2 lectures ago, right? Which is basically essentially the linear kernel raised to some power, right? The linear kernel inner product plus some constant raised to some power. And we saw how that very efficient to compute kernel function implicitly represents exponentially dimensional mappings, right, representing all possible monomials up to some degree in all the input variables. Okay, and then we last lecture also talked about other kernels like the Gaussian kernel, right, which is basically some form of similarity function that depends on the distance of 2 points, right? So it's defined as the exponentiated negative squared distance scaled by some bandwidth parameter h, length scale parameter h. We've also seen some similarities, right, so the Gaussian between the Gaussian kernel and nearest neighbor classification that we've briefly discussed last lecture. And we also discussed the similar kernel, the Laplacian kernel, which instead of looking at the squared distance and exponentiating it, the squared Euclidean distance and exponentiating it, the Laplace kernel just looks at the L1 distance between the 2 vectors and not squaring that, right? And so the names come from, right, some sort of analogs with the Gaussian or the Laplace distributions. That sort of explains maybe the nomenclature. There's other names that these are used, right, so especially the Gaussian kernel. There's many other names like ABF or squared exponential kernel. Okay, and so what we also discussed, and we'll revisit this idea, this lecture, is that once you choose a kernel, this, of course, implies some assumptions on the types of predictors that you're considering, right? And so in particular, what we've discussed, that once you commit to a particular choice of kernel, then the types of functions that you're fitting can always be written as linear combinations of kernel evaluation centered at your data points, right? So the functions that you work with essentially always have this form, right? So they can be written as f of x, which is the sum over all n data points. And for each data point, you have some coefficient alpha that's data point dependent, times the kernel evaluated at that data point and the argument that you give to the function, right, which is given here. And then if you would use the resulting function for classification, say, this just replaces the usual inner product w transpose x. You now have this function f of x that's defined in terms of these alphas, right? And then you would say threshold it by looking at its sign in order to come up with the binary classification. Okay, and of course this has, I mean, it's very important to be familiar with this quantity, right? Because if you use different kernels, your different forms of x, this will translate to different functions that you're implicitly considering. And we'll see this quite a bit again in this class. Okay. So what you also discussed is sort of how to derive new kernels from old ones using these composition rules, like sums and products of kernels, etc. Right. And of course, this translates to specific assumptions about the kind of predictors that you are considering, and we'll be revisiting this idea in this lecture as well. Okay, and so the last thing that we've done last lecture was basically we earlier had discussed the kernel trick in the context of the perceptron, and towards the end of last lecture, we showed how to apply that same kernel trick to the support vector machine, right? And since the support vector machine or SVM is very similar to the perceptron, it's no surprise that this can be kernelized as well, right? So the difference is that you also have this regularization term, right? And so that is easy to kernelize as well, as we've derived. And of course, the loss function is slightly different, right? It's the hinge loss, but it's, I mean, looks very similar to the perceptron. Okay, so this is basically just a quick recap. And we stopped sort of in the middle of the demo of the kernelized SVM, and I just want to continue that today, because I think it's really very instructive and very important to get some insight on how these resulting decision boundaries look like, what kind of kernels implied, which decision boundaries for which types of data sets, et cetera. So we'll continue with this now. And then what we're also going to do is we're going to use the kernel trick yet again, but not for classification, but for regression, and see how similar ideas apply to regression problems just as well. Okay, so let's go back, right? So this is basically the setup that we had talked about earlier, right? So let's just start this again. So this is basically one data set, right? So this two blobs data set that you've seen before, right? And this is just fitting the linear SVM, so the linear kernel, right? And it sort of tries to find this max margin solution. We've discussed a little how to see the effect of regularization, right? So we can now increase the regularization parameter, right? And that basically requires sort of a larger margin, right? And as we sort of increase the regularization more and more, we try to keep these weights small, right? You see the effect on the resulting decision boundary, right? So basically, these dashed lines are the points that have distance one, right, from the hyperplane, right? So where W transpose X is plus one or minus one, respectively, for the positive and negative class, right? And so everything that's sort of beyond these dashed lines is correctly classified up to margin, right? And everything inside is sort of violating the margin, right? It's contributing to the hinge loss, right? So that's the semantics of these kinds of pictures, right? And depending on how you choose the regularization parameter, right? You see the effect of this, right? If you use very little regularization, right, then you're sort of not insisting very much on the margin, right? You somehow really care about goodness of fit. You want to essentially have all points correctly classified in your training data set, right? But of course, that means that the resulting margin is very small. Okay, so this is the linear classification. You can use the polynomial kernel as well, right? Of course, I'll release that demo. You can play around with it more. So we can say, right, sort of increase, use the quadratic kernel, right? And so sort of get these interesting effects here, right, that there might be a little bit of the one class up here, right, just because of the shape of the quadratic. It's an indefinite quadratic that's being fit to the data, right, which just has the saddle point shape, right? And it just happens that there's sort of, it thinks there's part of the other class here as well, right? Can keep increasing this as well, right, and see sort of what happens with these resulting decision boundaries, right? And of course, we can again play around with the level of regularization, maybe increase the amount of regularization, and see what happens here, right? Okay, so I can also just increase the dimension of the polynomial kernel somewhat. Okay, so now this is clearly a linearly separable, I mean, almost linearly separable data set, right? There's a few outliers. You can sort of also reduce the noise a bit. Now it's actually linear separable, right? And so this sort of this effect that we had talked about earlier. Okay, good. So now let's look at some more interesting. So this is the polynomial kernel. Now let's look at what happens if we use the Gaussian kernel. Right, so there we don't control the degree, but we control this bandwidth parameter. So what happens, right, if we use a large bandwidth, it basically means that we put wide Gaussian bumps around every data point and weigh them somehow. That's the hypothesis that we are considering, right? So it means if we use a very large bandwidth parameter, we get these very smooth decision boundaries, right? And the limits here, right, this looks almost like a linear decision boundary that you get, right, if you use a very large bandwidth parameter. Okay, you basically insist on putting a really wide Gaussian around your data points, right, in order to find a good fit, right? The solutions most likely just put single Gaussian sort of far away in the positive and negative class, right? Okay? And now if you decrease the bandwidth parameter a lot, right, then you sum over very narrow Gaussian bumps, right? So let's do this. Increase more and more, right? So let's decrease the bandwidth parameter, length scale parameter more and more, right? And now you see these decision boundaries, right? Becoming narrower on the data point, right? So again, right? So the f of x is the sum of these Gaussians centered around each point, and essentially a Gaussian decays to something that's almost zero if you go some multiple of the length scale parameter away, right? Yes. Yeah. So why is that? Anyone have an explanation for that fact? So the question basically was, why are these points red here, right? So basically, why does this red region dominate the overall class label? Does anyone have an explanation for this?
Zero is a positive number?
Yeah, so it's sort of how to break ties, right? That's part of it, right? And I think the number of examples might be slightly larger in terms of the red examples, right? But it's really numerical issues. Essentially, it's zero everywhere here. And this is really now very arbitrary, okay? So essentially, anything that's sort of a, whatever, five, six times the length scale parameters away is essentially zero, contributes zero to f of x, right? And now you somewhat arbitrarily threshold.
Question.
Yes, question?
That model is very, very overfit
to the data. Aha, yes. So we haven't said about whether it's a good model and so on, right? So exactly. So this is here, right? So arguably, right, you would prefer a smoother decision boundary or something, right? So here you somehow really have a, this seems like it's very much overfit. What you can also do is you can increase the noise level, and this will exaggerate this even more, right? So we can do sort of, that's right? So now you have a whole bunch of blue examples here within the red, right? But in their vicinity, right? Basically, they're still controlling f of x, right? So they have push the function to be above zero, right? If the blue is the positive class, right? And of course, if we increase the bandwidth, right, then this is going to go away, right? Now these examples are actually negatively classified, right? And then as we keep increasing the bandwidth parameter, you get more smoother and smoother decision boundaries. So what's going to happen if I plug in the Laplacian kernel? So this is the Gaussian kernel. You can also choose the Laplacian kernel. So what's going to happen with the decision boundary? Any thoughts? Yes?
Or like
those
polyhedra around it?
Looks more like a polyhedra, more like straight line segments. It's not exactly piecewise linear, but close to piecewise linear. Okay? Can sort of try this, right? You sort of see this. Let's use a smaller regularization constant. So what's going to happen with the little ellipses around these Gaussian bumps, by the way, and you can think about this. So we had these little sort of ellipsoid-shaped islands around these examples that we had before. What kind of shapes will we have now? Just think about this a little bit. Right, see, it's sort of less and less smooth. But more and more ragged here, right? So you get these diamond shapes, right? And remember when we had talked about the lasso, right, L1 regularized regression, right? This was sort of the cost, the penalty term that you put on the weights, right? And we said the level sets are these diamonds, right? Which is sort of the same that happens here now, only that this is now part of the loss and not the regularizer. Okay? And here you see sort of nicely the much more ragged decision boundary that's imposed by the Laplacian kernel. Okay, so that's basically, you qualitatively get quite different behavior. We'll see that same thing again when we talk about regression later on. And also just to point out, so the Gaussian kernel we said is sort of super smooth. It's infinitely often differentiable, which is a very, very strong smoothness condition. And this Laplacian kernel, right, is not differentiable at the point, at least at each data point, right? So it's very, very ragged. Okay? And so it turns out there's a whole family of kernel functions that are between the Laplace kernel and the Gaussian kernel that control the level of smoothness. You can control how oftentimes differentiable these functions are, for example. Okay, so now this is all sort of boring, right? And linear classification tasks, right? So let's actually look at something maybe more, somewhat more interesting, maybe. So let's do the circles data set, right? This is this one here, right? I'll decrease the noise level a little bit for now, like this. Okay, so this is the circles data set, right? And now we can sort of try to think about what happens if we plug in different kernels. So first of all, I mean, clearly it's not linearly separable. That's the best linear fits, right? If you just fit the linear kernel. So let's try to fit one of the other kernel functions. So in particular, polynomial kernels. So you think that a polynomial kernel with degree 2 would correctly classify this data set? Would say yes. Bunch of yeses. Anyone say no? Okay, so most for yes, there's some hands for no. Let's just try it. Right, so this is no problem for the degree 2 polynomial kernel. Okay, so degree 3, will degree 3 still work? Who says yes? Who says no? Okay, so that's now more balanced, so let's try what happens. So let's try to fit it. Actually works perfectly fine, okay? So of course, in principle, right, it's just a strictly richer set of hypotheses you can fit with the data. Of course, it doesn't mean that if you actually solve the SVM problem with this kernel, you'll get the separation, right? And also, if you keep increasing the kernel, so the degree of the polynomial, things are just fine. Okay, so this works fine. So let's see what happens if you add some noise. Add some more noise, right? Let's do something like this. Maybe a bit more. So what's going to happen now? So let's try the quadratic kernel. Still sort of fine, right? Let's try to increase, see how much we can make it overfit, right? Use a larger, higher degree kernel, right? So now things are sort of a little more. If you hear, right, but of course that's far away from the data, right? There's no signal, right? So in terms of goodness of fit, we don't have any preference about what happens down here. So let's see if we decrease regularization. This is pretty strong regularization. Right, now you see that sort of things start to become more nasty, right? And we see some evidence overfitting. And we can just keep decreasing regularization. Right, and so of course you have more degrees of freedom, and sort of you try to get the not such a nice fit. Okay, so this is the polynomial kernel. Let's do see the extreme here, right? Now it's actually getting a difficult optimization problem as well, right? Because you have to sort of really fit carve out these islands here, right? So this is so now getting close to zero training error, right? Clearly overfitting to the data. Okay, good. Now let's go take a look at the different data sets. Let's go degree 1 and decrease the noise. Okay, and now let's say take the two moons. Okay, two moons data set. Okay, now again let's do the same exercise. So linear kernel clearly not linear separable, right? Shown here. Now what about degree 2? Well, a polynomial kernel of degree 2 perfectly separates that data? No. How about, would it not? Anyone who thinks it will not separate? Okay, so a lot of people say no. So let's see. Okay, so 2 doesn't work, right? But if you go to degree, how about degree 3? Will it work? Okay, so degree 3, it actually does work. Okay, and again, you can sort of increase and play this overfitting game, right? So here with little noise, it's not so much of a problem. If you do increase the amount of noise, enough, right, you start to see sort of overfitting happening here. Okay, good. So next, how about the Gaussian kernel, right? So let's try the Gaussian kernel. Will it separate the data? Yes, so let's see. Okay, so that's what you get. Let's see what happens if we change the bandwidth parameter, right? So the answer should have been depends, right? So if we increase it, what's going to happen if we increase the bandwidth parameter? Let's try. Right, now it's getting harder and harder, right? Because you insist on putting these really wide Gaussians around these points that don't adapt nicely to the shape of the moons, right? And there's no way to do this, at least to this level of regularization. Right, so if you increase it even further, right, you sort of fit the linear decision boundary again, right? So think of essentially Gaussian kernel with sort of a very varied bandwidth is sort of like the linear kernel. And again, right, if we decrease the bandwidth a lot, right, we see these little islands here, right? And of course, in the context of large noise, that is a great way to overfit, right? So, right, so you see these little pluses here, right? And if you decrease it even more, yes?
So your model sometimes tells that 0 is red and sometimes it's blue.
Uh-huh.
I cannot understand, like, either you treat 0 always as positive or you treat it always as negative.
Yeah, so...
it can be that explanation.
Right, so I'm actually not exactly sure about the number of examples that have been generating, right? Might be also slightly imbalanced, right? That is not exactly the same number of blue and red data points, because these are different data generators. So I don't know for sure, right? So somehow it's a tie-breaking issue. It's something that's extremely close to 0. Okay? Good. Yes, another question. Yeah.
Relatively low bandwidth. How is it possible that those little blue islands are appearing inside?
Inside here? This one here, for example?
No, because there's a point where that makes sense. But
the blue, here?
Yeah, inside where there's no points.
But there's no points.
Yeah.
Oh, here, those.
Yeah,
how does that? Yeah, this is, again, the time-breaking thing, right? Something that's extremely close to 0. So don't worry too much. So maybe for the visualization, it might have been better to just threshold at some epsilon and just put everything gray, that's epsilon, right? So basically, this don't give too much about whether this is now blue or red. So hopefully it's not causing too much confusion, right? So essentially, you sum some extremely small number, right? Sometimes weighted positively, sometimes weighted negatively, right? But in some sense, this is really numerical issues and time breaking. Okay, good. So this is this, right? Again, the same for the Laplace kernel, right? So let's just do this. Right now, these get, oops. Aha, interesting. So what's happening now? Can it not solve this? Huh. That's weird. No, it works. Okay. Not exactly sure what's going on here. I mean, it might also be some numerical issue that the solver breaks for some reason in the end, which I don't see here now. Okay? But here's basically, right, sort of what happens, right? So these little ellipses are now replaced by these diamond shaped objects. Okay. Good. Then next, let's do a kernel again, linear. This one, that's an interesting one. So, okay. Let's do this noise a little smaller, it becomes more clear. So this clearly not linearly separable, right? Again, polynomial kernel of degree 2. Will it perfectly separate the data or not? Who says yes? Good number of hands. Who says no? Some hands for no as well, so pretty balanced, so let's try it. Okay, and it actually works. Okay, and so why is that? Well, so we fit the quadratic but you don't fit the positive definite quadratic, right? So basically, there's positive and negative eigendirections, and that means the level sets are not actually ellipses. Okay, that's what happens here. Okay, so again, right, you can increase the noise, etc. Right, you can sort of try to make things overfit. If we decrease regularization. Okay. Don't want to crash the demo. Not sure what happened here. Yeah, I think it's... what happened now? Okay, so it might not have been able to solve the resulting problem. So there's a tolerance here when the demo will just break. So sometimes these problems get really badly conditioned, and it'll not actually be able to solve it. And I don't. This is not showing up here in the demo. Okay. Gaussian, right? So if you do the RBF, right, that's the kind of hopefully now familiar decision boundaries you would get. More and more smooth. If we increase regularization more and more, if we increase the bandwidth more and more, you get the linear boundary again, right? And if you make the bandwidth parameter very small, you get these very localized decision boundary, right? Okay, and so just the last one, the same for the Laplacian kernel, can increase the bandwidth parameter, right? It's much more almost piecewise linear decision boundaries, right? That come out of the shape of the kernel function, much less smooth. And the last, so here's another one. Let's try this one. Okay, so here's another one. So another Gaussian polynomial kernel of degree 2, will it fit? Any yeses? Any noes? Okay, a whole bunch of noes. So hopefully we're building some intuition here. So no will not work, right? Degree 3, will it work? Yes. Okay, degree 3 will work. We'll do it, right? And the same game as we had talked about before, right? We can now do RBF or Laplacian kernel, right? And play around with the effect of the bandwidth parameter and so on, right? And so I'll put the demo online, right? And you can play around it with it yourself. But I thought it's important to actually go through this. Is there any more questions about this? So that's certainly very important, right, to understand sort of what are the consequences of these different modeling choices, right, and how the choice of a kernel has some effect on the decision boundaries you get. Questions, yeah?
So I think I maybe forget, but the orientation for the Laplacian and the Gaussian, I remember just something symmetric, so when did we introduce
So this is just an isotropic, so it's still symmetric, right, but so x and y axis, this is a matter of scaling here. I think the axes are not quite... Right, so here this is ranging just from minus 1.5 to 1.5, and it's ranging from minus 1 to 4, right? So if you were to scale this equally, then this would actually be... Yeah. Is that what you're asking?
No, first is the orientation of these guys.
This here?
Yeah, I mean, why is not... So when did I choose the x?
Oh, because that's because of the... I mean, Jacques, the sum of absolute differences. Right, e to the sum of the absolute differences. Cool. And that's sort of the shape, right? So essentially, the level sets, they're oriented in this way. Okay, good. So that's that. And now, this is basically what I wanted to say about the kernelized SVM. It's a super useful classifier, especially in settings where you don't have massive amounts of data. Okay, so kernelized SVMs are sort of one of the techniques that just should be tried if you have a classification problem, right? Because super stable, super robust, very effective, and especially in contexts where you don't have sort of huge amounts of data, right? So if you have a machine learning problem with a few, tens of thousands of points or so, right? You can also, with some tricks, scale it beyond try kernelized SVMs, right? Try scaling to larger data sets. SVMs are a little tricky, but there's some tricks as well, right? So definitely a very, very useful and widely effective method to know about. Okay, even if everyone these days talks about neural nets, SVMs actually can be very, very effective. Okay, good. Now, kernelized linear regression. So we talk about classification, right? So one of the prototypical supervised learning tasks, the other one being regression that we've talked about. And so now, what can we do here? And so we can basically do the same, right? But I think it's useful to still go through it to give another example of the kernel trick and also get some more intuition of what you model with kernels. So here's the idea. We use the same rationale that we used when talking about the perceptron, right? We said when solving the perceptron or the SVM, we found that the optimal W is in the span of the data. That was the premise, right? Turns out that same premise holds for regression just as well, for least squares regression, okay? And so why is that? Again, sort of the same, there's many different ways to show it, right? You can abstractly show it with the representative theorem. One argument that we used for the perceptron was that if you were to use a gradient-based algorithm starting at zero, all the solutions you construct are of this form, right? And we can do the same rationale for regression as well, right? So if you remember the gradient, right? So the gradient of, say, R hat, of W, right, if this is the empirical risk, right, this is just the sum over the points of the residual, right, so this is what we had derived last time, yi minus W transpose xi times xi, right, this is the gradient, and this is basically just the scalar ri, and so multiplied with xi, right, so if you go in a gradient direction, you just keep adding some multiple times the data points to your current solution, right? So if you start with the all zero solution, you sort of only move in directions of your data, then it's always going to be preserved, right? So that same argument still holds for say least squares regression. Okay, and so we can do the same exercise in kernelized linear regression. So let's do it. So this is basically, right? So optimization problem, the regularized least squares problem, or which regression problem. And this is our ansatz, right? W star being the sum over all n data points of alpha I times xi. So we write, right? So this is our hat of W, right? Is the sum over I equals 1 through n of, now you put the ansatz for W, right? So we have sum over j is 1 through n of alpha I xi. Note there's no y here, right? Before we had alpha I, y I, x I, the way we parameterized it. Now there's no y I here. Slightly different, right? But otherwise, it's basically the same. Transpose, that's just a w, x I. This is j here. This is x I minus y I squared plus, okay, so this is this, right? And now, of course, here we can do the same sort of rearrangement, just distribute the xi into the sum, sum over j of alpha j xj transpose xi minus yi whole thing squared, and then this here, just you observe that this is, we just replace this now with the kernel, right? That's the same, okay? And then the other is how to take this regularizer here, right? And that's, we've seen something similar already when discussing the SVM, right? Same thing happens here, right? So the two norms squared is just W transpose W, which is plugging in that sum, right? We get the sum over I, okay, let me just spell it out, from 1 to n, alpha I xi times the sum over j, alpha j xj, right, which is just a big double sum from I equals j from 1 to n of alpha I alpha j xi transpose xj, right? And then, of course, this is just our kernel. Right, that's the kernel trick, right? And now just replacing, so we can write this more compactly, as just alpha transpose k alpha, where k is this kernel matrix, then by n kernel matrix. It's just what this double sum is. Okay, so this is basically our recipe, right, for kernelizing something, right? Now applied to ridge regression, right? And so just a little bit more in terms of notation. So this part we've derived before, right, alpha transpose k alpha. I just want to simplify this part a little bit. So this is the equation that we derived on the previous slide, right? So if you think about, so if this is our kernel matrix, right, with these rows and columns, right? If you think about what we're doing here, this expression, right? What are we doing here? Well, so we sum over the components of alpha, right, times elements from this matrix K, right? In particular, what happens here, right, is we basically take alpha times one column of K, right? So for each term, each I here, we basically multiply alpha, this vector alpha, with the ith column of our matrix. So if you think about this matrix here, right, as basically being composed of columns k1 through kn, right, then what we're doing here, this is just alpha transposed ki minus yi squared. Right, is that clear? So we just, right, take the alphas, right, and so this is just basically in a product, right, between the alpha vector and the column of this matrix K. And now what happens is, so basically for each I, we compute this and square it. Did we, something wrong? Hopefully it's correct, right? So I mean, I have to, I guess, do it like this, right? So, okay. So, right? And so, and then now this here, of course, if you sum this, we can just as well write this here as alpha transpose the entire matrix K minus the vector Y 2 norm squared, right? So instead of just doing this sort of row by row, sorry, column by column of this matrix, assembling this one vector and then looking at the sum of the squared elements of that vector, we can just compute the full vector directly just as alpha transpose k. That's just what happens in this, if you take the entire sum, right? And then looking at the Euclidean length of that whole thing. Hope that's clear, right? So this is really just collecting the indices and knowing there's nothing, just vector matrix multiplication, okay? Any questions, or did I mess up some index? Hopefully not. Okay, yes. Why is the column vector, yeah? Aha, so did we, maybe we have to put a transpose here. Good. Just checking if you pay attention. Okay, good, so no, of course. So this is, by the, so the dimensions need to match, right? But this is what basically happens here. Okay? Good, right? And so now that's sort of basically this really clean, simple notation, right, of kernelized ridge regression, which basically means even after applying this kernel trick, you still basically just have to solve a least squares problem, but a slightly reformulated one. This is just collected, I mean, collecting what we had on the previous slide, right, that now basically the kernelized ridge regression problem is basically this problem of optimizing over these alpha vectors here, right? So one coefficient per data point of alpha transpose k minus y Euclidean norm squared plus lambda times alpha transpose k alpha, right? So where this comes from the regularization, and this is the goodness of fit term. And so it's maybe no surprise, right, that this also has a closed form solution. So you can take that objective, compute its gradient, set it to zero, and you'll get this condition here, right? Which basically says that the optimal solution of alpha is actually given by just taking the kernel matrix plus lambda times the identity, taking the inverse and multiplying with y, right? Or solving a linear system, essentially, with this matrix k plus lambda I. Okay, so it looks similar to the rich regression, slightly different. But it's basically directly operating in kernel space. And of course, this is learning, right? So this is now, given the data, we basically compute the kernel matrix and compute this equation, right, to get our alpha star. And then in order to do prediction, right, so what would we do? Well, we just use our ansatz, right? We know what our W is, right? We know what W transpose X is, right? So here, let's just talk about this again, right? So W transpose X, right, is sum over I equals 1 through N. Right, this was replaced, right? So let me write it like this, right? So this was replaced by alpha I kernel, sorry. Okay, anyway, so it's equal, right, before applying the kernel trick, right? Xi, this is just the form of W transpose X, right? And then, of course, this is just 1 to N of alpha I Xi transpose X, distributing that x into this sum here, right? And then observing that this is just the kernel xi comma x, right? That's where we get this. Okay, so now there's no y's here in this formula, right? So it looks slightly different than what we had for classification, but it's basically the same thing. Okay, so it means that we can use the same kernel trick, right? To reformulate this this rich regression problem. Use it also in order to make predictions. We get a very similar kind of predictors, right? Again, this would be our f of x, which is the sum of weighted kernel evaluation centered around our data points, right? And so the same rationale that we had when discussing decision boundaries, right, and the various choices of kernels just applies in exactly the same way here. Here as well. Just a comment, right? Of course, instead of solving this closed form solution here, right, one can also use gradient-based methods and so on in order to optimize it in principle. Okay, good. So let's actually, let me skip this for a second. Let me just do one more thing, and we'll do a demo in a moment. So what happens if we do just a sanity check, right? So we've talked about this, the form of our predictors, right? And now, if you were to use the linear kernel, right? So if k of x comma xy is the linear kernel, then what happens to f of x? Well, of course, it's just sum over I equals 1 through n alpha I that we got somewhere of xi transpose x, right? And then, of course, we can do the same reasoning, right, to just say group things differently now, xi, right, grouping those together, and this is our transpose x, right? And then this is just our w, right? So it means that if we do kernelized rich regression, right, and we use the linear kernel, then, I mean, it shouldn't be a surprise if we just get linear regression back, which is what the slide says. Right, so because linear combinations of kernel evaluations. Okay, and so that rationale can be pushed in interesting ways, and I want to just mention this. So this is sort of what happens if you use kernelized rich regression, and then you plug in the linear kernel. But of course, you can sort of, again, try to understand, what if I now use a different kernel? What kind of functions do I get back? Right, and what do I effectively use as my hypothesis class when fitting my data? Right, and so in particular, this leads to ideas that are often very useful for modeling. So, for example, so we've talked about the issue with the Gaussian kernel, right? The issue with the Gaussian kernel is that it's very localized, right? So we saw these little Gaussian bumps around individual data points, right? So it's very local modeling the hypothesis, the functions very locally around each data point. On the other hand, if you use a parametric model like the linear kernel, then of course there's just one single global model, right? That's very rigid. Okay, so using somehow, right, parametric models like the linear model might impose too rigid modeling assumptions on the data. But at the same time, using sort of these purely non-parametric models like the Gaussian kernel might fail to capture global trends. Right, so it might model things sort of purely based on each data point. And of course, one can sort of try to get the best of both worlds, right, by combining them in some way. And one way to concretely do this is to use these kernel engineering rules that we had talked about earlier, right, where you might now say, well, what if I combine a linear kernel with a Gaussian kernel? Right, so I might consider taking a kernel K as a linear combination, non-negative linear combination of my Gaussian kernel and my linear kernel, right? And so then, of course, if you do that, again, you can ask, what kind of functions do you model in the end, right? And so you can, again, try to work this out, right? So we know f of x is the sum over I equals 1 through n of alpha I k of x and xi, which is expanding our definition of the kernel here, right, going from 1 to n of alpha I ci, right, some constant of how to weigh the Gaussian kernel. Oh, there's a minus missing here, sorry. Minus x minus xi 2 norm squared divided by h squared plus c2 times x transpose xi transpose x, right? This is just plugging in the form of the kernel. But now again, of course, I can manipulate that expression and collect terms, right? And what I get back is just sum over I equals 1 through n so let me just put this here, right? C1 times sum over alpha I e to the minus xi 2 norm squared divided by bandwidth squared plus C2 times a sum over I equals 1 through n xi, alpha I, sorry. Xi, this is already doing the same rationale in the previous slide, collecting those together, times xi, and this here, of course, is just, aw, right? So it means that if I use this kind of kernel, then what do I get back? Well, I basically get a linear model plus a sum of a bunch of Gaussian bumps, right? And the alphas are now optimized to trade the goodness of fits, right, with the complexity, right? So that basically now balancing the linear part and the Gaussian bump part. Okay, and you'll see an application of this in a demo in just a moment, but I would propose that we take the break now, and then we'll discuss this in more detail after the break. Okay, please sit down again. I'd like to continue. Okay, so we have seen another instantiation of the kernel trick, namely to the rich regression problem, right, which led us to kernelized rich regression. And so we've derived the algorithm, talked about how do these resulting predictors look like, right? And what we just discussed before the break was basically if we use some of these kernel engineering rules that we've discussed before, right? In particular, say, defining a kernel as a sum of two kernels, then now, since we know something about the form of these predictors, we can understand something about the form of the hypotheses that the model that we'll be trying to fit when solving the kernelized rich regression problem. Right? And so one application of this was basically trying to fit semi-parametric models, right? Models that have sort of a parametric component, like a linear or polynomial component, and a non-parametric component, like the Gaussian kernel. Okay, and so let me give you an example of where this might be useful. So let's look at the following problem. Here, okay. So this is a data set. We have both the test examples shown in red here, right? These red stars are training points. And these blue examples are our test points. Okay? And so here, we want to try to make predictions, right? Obviously about the label of these blue points, right? By fitting a model on the training examples. Now, note one thing I want to show here is that we have examples only on part of the domain, right? So that here our test points, right, live in this interval from 0 to 10, but our training examples are only on the interval from 0 to 5. Okay, and now we can see what happens if we use different kinds of kernels to solve the kernelized rich regression problem on that data set. So what this already shows here, this slide, is what happens if we apply the linear kernel, right? So linear kernel, as we said, is just linear regression, right? It just solves the rich regression problem, and that's the fit that you would get. And even though we've seen examples only down here, we somehow capture this global trend, right, that extends, extrapolates in some way, right, in regions where we don't have data. Of course, we can try other kinds of kernels, right? So in particular, we could try to use the polynomial kernel. Just go down here. Let's use the polynomial kernel. And we can sort of try to use different different degrees, right? Say a quadratic or cubic. Sorry, cubic or higher order polynomials, right? And then, of course, we start to overfit to our training examples at some point. Right, so that's what we would maybe expect here. Okay, now what's going to happen if we use the Gaussian kernel on that data set? Any thoughts? Yeah? When we'll drop down. And why is that? Well, so if you use basically these Gaussian bumps, right, they drop decay to zero beyond the length scale parameter, right, or something close to zero. So whatever is outside the range of my data, right, plus maybe the length scale parameter, will basically be predicted to be zero. So let's see whether this actually happens. So let's try to use the Gaussian kernel. And here's what happens, right? So this is a fit with a given length scale parameter, right? You do model the data in this part of the domain, right? But then it actually just drops to zero, right? Because there is no point close by, right? That would contribute to the prediction. Yes. Once again, can you repeat? Right here, it goes down. Yeah, so basically, remember, so the f of x that we fit, the predictor, is a sum over kernel evaluation, so Gaussian bumps, centered around our training points. But the training points are only these red points. And we have red points only in this first part here, right? So from 0 to 5. There's no red points down here. So it means we have essentially a whole bunch of Gaussian bumps weighted somehow, but only in this part of the data. So now what's going to happen if I change the length scale parameter? Okay, so if I increase it, it'll be smoother somehow. If I decrease it, it'll be sharper somehow. So you can try to look at both of them. So let's look at what happens if we shrink the length scale parameter. Anyone have an idea what happens if I let this h parameter, this bandwidth parameter, go to zero? We basically get something like a bunch of delta functions that try to interpolate the data. So let's test this, right? So let's use the kernel width that's smaller and smaller, right? So we get this sort of phenomenon here, right? So we perfectly interpolate every single data point, right? Get zero training error. But obviously, this is not useful at all for prediction, right? That's a nice example of overfitting. OK, so now let's look at the converse. So what happens if we increase the length scale parameter? If I make it wider and wider, you said it's right, so it's smoother and smoother, right? But of course, at some point, we somehow have to be so smooth, right, that we don't actually manage to perfectly interpolate the data anymore, right? So we do extend a little bit further here, right, because the bandwidth parameter now goes wider. But of course, now since we have to somehow fit this function, right, with our Gaussian bumps, if we pick wide Gaussian bumps, we will not be able to interpolate the data well. Okay, so let's increase this width. What happens if you do more and more? Right, so now it actually starts to look something more like a linear regression, similar to what we had thought about what we've seen in linear classification, right, that we get something that's almost like a linear decision boundary in the domain where we have data. And then here, of course, it does decay. All right, that's sort of what happens here. Okay, so what's going to happen if I increase the regularization? We squish things down, right? So we decrease the data, right? So I push this down to zero, right? So eventually, our regularization wants all alphas to be zero. Okay, so that's what happens here. Okay. good. Now let's see what happens with the Laplace kernel. Right, so there, similar sort of behavior, right? Now we have a sum of these more spiky, right, these Laplace kind of kernel evaluations, right, that are non-differentiable at x equal x prime, right? And so what happens now, so something that's actually interesting, we get similar effects as for the Gaussian kernel, right? So if we decrease the bandwidth, we should expect similar things to happen, right? So if we decrease the bandwidth, then somehow eventually we'll get this sort of bunch of spikes, right? Something is almost like a sum of delta functions. If we increase it, though, what happens? So if we increase it more and more, increase it more and more. Do you notice a difference to what we had with the Gaussian kernel? Anyone see a difference? So let's look at the Gaussian kernel again. See if I can do the switch here. Okay, so this is too wide of a bandwidth. Right, so here, this is the trade-off that we had, right? So as we make it smoother and smoother, it doesn't fit the points anymore, right? Gets right more and more linear, right? More and more smooth here, right? Versus if you use the Laplace kernel, it still tries to interpolate the points here, right? And that's because the function is a lot less smooth. Right, so qualitatively, you see different behaviors in the resulting models that you fit. Right, of course, you can see what happens if we increase regularization. Now, if you do increase regularization, we can avoid this. Right, so we can sort of avoid just interpolating the data, but still, right, you do see this kind of behavior, right, where you sort of try to fit the points where there are some. Okay, so insisting too much in smoothness of these resulting models might actually not be a good idea. So even though the Gaussian kernel is very widely used, it's oftentimes too smooth for problems that you want to model. Okay, using something like not necessarily the Laplace kernel, but there's other kernels that sort of have intermediate levels of smoothness, can actually be very useful. Okay, so let's see. Let's go back here. Small regularization. And now let's do the following. So this behavior was actually generated, so we generated it basically as a sum of a linear function and a periodic function. So what you can try to do is you can try to capture that periodic behavior. Okay, and so let me just show you what I mean by this. So here, the kernel width models the frequency of the period that we tried to capture. So let me just give you, just mention here, so the periodic kernel. So there's no such, okay. So what I'm referring to as a periodic kernel here is actually just a Gaussian kernel after applying a manual feature transformation. So what I've done here is basically I've just defined k of x and x prime to be the Gaussian kernel after applying sine of x times some frequency parameter minus sine of x prime. Sorry, I should better go inside here. X prime times h. So it's just a scalar, right? Squared. And that's another bandwidth parameter out here. Let me just put, okay. Let's just put the h squared here. And this is, say, let's call this gamma. What a nice gamma. All right, so gamma is sort of the period, right? If I increase gamma or decrease gamma, I'll get more and more, I'll change the period of the resulting function that I'm capturing, right? So what this means is, essentially, instead of directly modeling x and x prime, I first apply this manual transformation, right, of mapping x to sine of gamma times x. And then I just apply the Gaussian kernel after that transformation. Right? So it means that if x and x prime, they're off by 2 pi, right? Or in this case, 2 pi times gamma, whatever, right? So basically, they're the same again. That's sort of what captures periodic behavior. Why is this a valid kernel? So it turns out that if I take my data, I mean, I'm free to do whatever feature transformation I want to do before even starting to apply a kernel method, right? I can just take my data and do some sine transform, right? Compute some nonlinear features of it, and then just apply the Gaussian kernel after the transformation. And since the Gaussian kernel is a valid kernel, I get a valid kernel back. That's all we've done here, right? We just changed the representation of our data, right? Before even applying the Gaussian kernel. Okay, so that's what I meant by this, right? And now, this is sort of the fit that we get here. Again, right, from this least squares fit. If we use this kernel function that we had on the previous slide. So why is that? Anyone have an idea of why we see this kind of behavior? Well, it doesn't seem to go through the data at all. I mean, it seems to capture some sort of periodic phenomenon, but it's not really going through the data. Any thoughts on why this is sort of what we get? Yes? Yeah? No?
The sine of x is always between 0 and 1, or minus 1 and 1.
Yeah. Note that if you look at f of x, right, you get a sum over alpha times, sure, right? So and that scales things, right? So the scaling is not, is taken care of from the alphas, right? Yes?
Seems like it's kind of going through the middle of the red points.
Yeah.
So between the x and the x primes.
Right.
Because of the oddness of the sign.
Okay, so it does sort of try to fit those points here, right? But I mean, the real reasons why it sort of goes like this is, and by design, the resulting functions, they're essentially, right, so let's actually try to work out, right, what are those functions, right? So f of x is basically a sum over I equals 1 through n of alpha I times k of xi comma x, right? That's just our usual form, right? Which is sum over I equals 1 through n of alpha I e to the minus whatever we have here, right? Basically, sine xi times gamma minus sine of x prime, sorry, of x, right? That argument to f times gamma. Whole thing squared divided by h squared, right? And so this is our function f of x, right? Now, if you think about each of these terms here inside that sum, the only varying parameter here, right, is now our x, right? And obviously, if I just replace x by 2 pi over gamma, I get the same value again, right? So no, right? So it means that f of x is the same as f of x plus 2 pi over gamma, right? So because then this gamma just cancels here, right? And it's just replaced, basically shifted this right by 2 pi, right? So this means we always guarantee to model periodic functions, right? Where this gamma basically models the frequency, right? Models the period. Okay, so this is the shape of the functions that that we model by the choice of the kernel function, right? So it means that we need to, right, find such a periodic function, right, of the shape, and among all those, we sort of try to find one that fits the data well. That explains why you get this kind of fit. Okay, so now what can we do? Well, so we can sort of change the frequency, right? So if we increase it here, right, this sort of, we try to fit higher and higher frequencies. If we go sort of course, there's some aliasing going on, right? So if you decrease this, you get something that's smoother and smoother. Right? That's what happens here. Okay, good. So now we talked about the semi-parametric idea, right? Of sort of trying to put things together. So let's do this. And so in particular, let's now take the polynomial kernel plus the Gaussian kernel. Okay? So this is what happens if I use the polynomial kernel plus the Gaussian kernel. Right? What we basically derived a few slides ago, right? So we talked about essentially just sum the Gaussian kernel and the linear kernel together, right? And this is the resulting fit, right? And of course, we can again change the bandwidth, this bandwidth parameter, right? And now we see that in places where we do have data, we sort of try to fit it, and otherwise, we just capture this linear trend. And we explain our data as the sum of the linear term and sort of a bunch of Gaussian bumps centered around these points. Okay? So that's sort of the effect that we would get, right? And of course, if we increase the kernel width again a lot, right, we get something that's sort of more smooth. Okay? And so now, of course, the last thing is what you might do here, and this is actually how the data was generated, you might say, well, maybe there's both the linear component and this periodic component that you want to add to it. Right, so let's do that. So this is basically this here. Right? And now we would say if we can change this gamma parameter, right? And so if we happen to get that one right, we in this case actually perfectly fit the data. So this is sort of how the data actually was generated. It's sort of within this hypothesis class. Okay? So that's sort of the idea, right? By sort of understanding the choice of the kernel here, right? The hypothesis class that you fit, right? You're implicitly making some assumptions in the data, right? And that's sort of what's captured here. Yes?
Is there any way to pick the frequency?
Aha, so now the question is how do you pick these hyperparameters, right? And so, I mean, that's the general, right? So we've talked about, maybe we can do it now, so I have some slides later, right? But so all of these kernels have some parameters, right? The polynomial has the degree, the Gaussian has the bandwidth, right? The periodic kernel, maybe in addition, this frequency component, and so on, right? And in the first place, you might want to say which of these kernels should we pick, right? So this was, I mean, done by visual inspection here, right? Of course, you'd want to do this automatically. Right? I mean, all of these things, these decisions, are hyperparameters, right? Are modeling choices. And how do we go about selecting these hyperparameters? Right? So, exactly, right? I mean, we use the tools that we have for this, right? So we would essentially experiment with these different choices and validating the predictive performance via cross-validation. Right? And so now, maybe what you could think about, and this is maybe what you might be getting at here, right? So now, of course, if you do something like, do I choose the polynomial over the Gaussian kernel? This is sort of a discrete decision, right? So there, maybe I don't really get around to trying both of things, right? But here, well, so I have the Gaussian, I have this bandwidth parameter, right? Or I have this frequency parameter, et cetera, right? That's actually a continuous quantity, right? Can I somehow try to optimize that as well, right? And so there are some ways of actually sort of trying to differentiate with respect to these continuous parameters as well, right? So if you think about this essentially, right, this is difficult to do in general, so say for an SVM or something like this, right? But for kernelized rich regression, if you think about this form, right, that's basically the optimization problem that we have to solve. Now, k itself is a function of these hyperparameters, say k of h. And of course, in principle, we could just go ahead and try to differentiate with respect to h and do something like gradient descent, right, or some sort of optimization with respect to these hyperparameters. Then that can be done. And so these sort of things are used sometimes in the context of kernel methods where you would sort of try to actually do, say, gradient-based optimization with respect to some of these hyperparameters. Okay, so in this case, you might just, say, do cross-validation with respect to the choice of kernel, but then maybe do continuous, right, so gradient-based optimization in order to optimize the parameters, the continuous parameters. But I won't discuss this here, but it's maybe that's what you've been asking. Okay, good. So let's go back to this. So this is basically here, okay, just what we had mentioned, right? So this was actually a function we had used to generate the data, right? So this the blue function here, right? And this is the sample data, right? And this is the different fits that we had discussed before. Okay, just one example. So about the sort of a real world application of using kernel methods and sort of real data. So here's using sort of not these sums of kernels, but actually using graph kernels here on a particular application of trying to design synthetic proteins. So this is a collaboration we had a while ago with chemical engineers. And what they want to do is they want to basically design proteins that have certain desirable chemical properties. So in particular, they were working with a family of enzymes called P450S. And so one of the use cases is that they're kind of the contrast agents in medical imaging, in fMRI imaging, right? So it's basically a family of biologically active enzymes, right? And there's actually a whole family of such proteins that have been constructed in the lab. And now the question is, can you use them as a starting point to sort of design and explore the space of synthetically generated proteins? So that's sort of the problem that that our collaborators have been studying there. And so basically the way they go about this, so that's the experimental technique, is they would take some parent sequences. So these are candidate descriptions of proteins. And now what they would do is they would break them apart, as sort of shown in this picture here, and reassemble them to create chimeras, to create sort of new proteins that you might be able to synthesize, right? So because you essentially glue together these different pieces. And now this basically gives you a whole bunch of candidate sequences that you could generate. And among all of those, What they want to do is they want to find the best ones. Now, what is the best one? That, of course, depends very much on the application, but there's sort of different ways of quantifying the utility of such candidate sequences. And so one of the metrics that they look at is, for example, thermostability. So how quickly, how long sort of does the protein last in a particular environmental condition, experimental condition. They might also look at binding affinity and sort of other quantities. So essentially, once you synthesize one such protein, right, you can measure how good it is. And now you can sort of try to see, well, can we use maybe machine learning in order to make predictions given a subset of sequences that they've experimented with, how well others might do that they haven't tried, right? And then use that in order to figure out which next experiments to run, right? That's sort of the problem that we had collaborated on in that paper that I'm referring to. And so basically, so you can sort of think about this basically and this kind of cartoon plot here where the x-axis is the set of possible sequences you might generate and the y-axis is this performance, say thermostability, right? And now the idea is if you could generate, right, if you generate synthetically a bunch of these instances, you sort of would try to solve a regression problem, right, in order to make predictions about sequences that you haven't tried yet, right? And then maybe use these models in order to decide where to go next. Okay? And so now, how does this fit with what we've been discussing? Well, so the methods we've been exploring there basically have been using graph kernels. So in this case, essentially, so there's a lot known about the structures of these resulting proteins, and there's some notion of similarity between different proteins that you can quantify using a kernel. And I will not discuss this in too much detail, but just to give you a little bit of intuition, it basically captures these sort of intuitions that if you have two proteins that are sort of differing only in terms of some surface mutation, they're considered much more similar than if they differ with respect to some mutation in the core, right? That's sort of the kind of prior assumption that's captured by the kernel function that's used there, right? So they inspect essentially a sort of a 3D graph structure describing that resulting protein and would derive the notion of similarity, which is captured by a kernel, right? And so that turns out to actually fit pretty well. So here's basically predictions and actual measurements of thermostability among a family of proteins that they had generated before. So it's pretty strong correlation. And they can actually use this in order to guide experimentation. So what we've done there, and I will not discuss this here, but I want to mention this as an outline. So we've talked about kernel-rich regression, which is basically this problem of sort of trying to fit the nonlinear function. Right here, it's now not a function on RD, right, but a function on the space of proteins, right? So some sort of more abstract space, right, of protein structures. And now you sort of try to solve a regression problem, right, maybe predicting thermostability or some other quantity that you might care about. And you can capture it using basically exactly what we've discussed here in the class, right? So you choose a suitable kernel function and basically solve kernel-rich regression. Now, if you want to actually use these methods in order to do experimentation, right? So what we've been looking at in this context is you actually want to use these methods in order to propose the next experiment, right? You want to say, given what I know, where should I look next? Okay? And so that actually requires to not just make predictions, but also make predictions about uncertainty. So you also want to be able to quantify the uncertainty in that kind of prediction. And so it turns out there's a very natural probabilistic analog of kernelized rich regressions called Gaussian processes, and that's what we've been using in this work. So it's basically quantifying, so not just fitting a single function, but actually modeling a distribution over functions. And so a kernelized rich regression can be understood as sort of the most likely function under that model. Okay, but in addition, you actually do get predictive uncertainty, and I will not discuss this here too much in this class, but this is sort of a bit of an outlook, right? But the actual predictor that's being used is exactly what we've discussed here, like the same, basically, that I just showed you in a demo, right? Just with a different kind of kernel, okay? And so what they've basically using this is they essentially fit a model based on past data that they had used, right? That they had experimented with in the lab in order to have this Gaussian process model quantifying the uncertainty in a prediction about thermostability, and then using algorithms that we had been developing in order to trade explorations or doing experiments where you would sort of collect useful data to fit the better model, but at the same time using what you've learned in order to somehow explore parts of the space that would be predicted to be useful, right? That's sort of a high-level description. Of course, you can take a look at the paper for some more details. And using this, they actually were able to synthesize new sequences that were considerably more stable than those that they had found using methods that they had experimented before. And this is a problem that they actually have been working on for quite a while. Okay, so this is just sort of showing one real-world use case of kernel-rich regression, right, and related methods. Okay, so basically, this is a really useful and powerful set of techniques. There's been a lot of work on kernels for specific types of domains, right? Particular type of objects like graph structures, for example, here, right? And using basically just this machinery that we've discussed, you can actually get very good results. Okay, so just before we wrap up, right? So we already talked about this question of choosing kernels and choosing kernel parameters, right? So there's these general questions, right? Which kernel do we pick and how do we pick good parameters? We already discussed this. We want to use cross-validation. And then, of course, the question on how to select suitable kernels. And of course, this is, again, right, this basic questions. How do you pick good representations, which is an essential challenge in, all across machine learning, right? So you need to somehow, right, the more you know about your domain, the better model you have about the domain, right? So this, I think, protein function prediction example that I just mentioned is a nice example of this, where you can actually impose domain knowledge that you have about the particular application, right? So the more sort of domain knowledge you can encode about your choice of kernels, the less data you get away with, right? The more you have to learn from scratch, the more data you need. It's sort of very natural. Okay, and then this is, of course, one, right? And then you can go ahead and sort of try to either explicitly model, right? Sort of think about what kind of kernels you might combine in what ways, what kind of functions do you imply this way. And of course, you can sort of try to search over these sort of combinations. So, and there's quite a bit of work on systematic ways of even thinking about searching for the right combinations of such kernels. Okay, and of course, there's also work on actually trying to learn the kernel itself. Quite a large literature on this, right? So this relates to what we had talked about earlier. So actually, for a given kernel, sort of how to optimize over kernel parameters. So one thing you could, for example, do is, so suppose you have a bunch of candidate kernels, say the linear kernel, polynomial kernel of given degrees, Gaussian kernel, Laplace kernel, etc. So what you could do is you could say, well, I posit that my kernel is a convex combination of all these kernels. So I know that K is a sum of I, of beta I times ki, where each ki is a given kernel function. And then now you have a bunch of parameters, beta I, that you could try to optimize over. Okay? And there's methods that do this, right? So I called multiple kernel learning, for example. Right? So there's ways of sort of trying to learn a good kernel function. Okay? And so there's other frameworks going beyond this as well, right? And this will lead us to topics we'll discuss further down the road in this class, namely how can you try to learn good representations from data. Okay, so that's basically it we've seen this demo. Just talking a little bit about sort of overfitting, right? So basically the issue with, right? So the conceptual issue with kernels, of course, is that you somehow map into these extremely high-dimensional spaces, right? So so we talked about polynomial kernels, where sort of the dimensionality is exponential. We talked about the Gaussian kernel, right, where you even implicitly map to infinite-dimensional feature spaces, etc., right? And so, I mean, there's a natural question of why should this work at all, right? Why shouldn't always overfit, right? And of course, you can overfit, and we've seen examples of this, right? So the sort of reasons or intuitions why you can combat overfitting, right, is that first of all, you don't actually work in this infinite dimensional feature space, right? Because you effectively only have these alpha variables, right? So you effectively do have a set of parameters, you just have a lot of them, right? You have one parameter per data point, right? So that's sort of one explanation that even though you implicitly work in this extremely high dimensional space, you effectively only work in a finite dimensional space, right? That's parameterized, so the number of degrees of freedom agree with the number of examples that you have, right? And that's now something that you can get under control basically via via regularization, right? And that's what we've discussed both in context of the support vector machine and in context of kernelized rich regression, right? Where you balance goodness of fit with the complexity of the resulting model. Okay, so that's basically wrapping up kernels. Kernels are efficient, implicit inner products, right? With this connotation of being some form of similarity function, right? We've talked about their properties. We've seen examples. We've talked about the kernel trick, right? And seen several applications, starting with the perceptron. We talked about the SVM. We talked about kernelized linear regression as well. There's many other examples. You'll see some more later on in this course. We talked a bit about how to choose kernels, and we've talked about some relation to methods like nearest neighbor classification. So to keep building up our picture here, right? So this is what we had talked about earlier, right? So we've our basic methods in classification and regression, right? So if you take rich regression and linear SVMs as a starting point, right, as well as the perceptron, you can sort of think about now adding a new dimension, which is this kernelization, right? So if you start with the perceptron, you get the kernelized perceptron. If you start with rich regression, you get the kernelized rich regression. And sort of from the linear SVM, we get to the kernelized SVM. And in terms of, so here maybe you can relate it to sort of this k-nearest neighbor problem as sort of a special case of doing CSVMs or perceptrons with the Gaussian kernel, right? Sort of where you get this nearest neighbor type of effect, right? And in terms of the different dimensions and supervised learning, right? Basically, this has been elaborating on our representation or features dimension, right? So how do we go about choosing families of hypotheses that we reason about? Okay, so that's what I wanted to cover for today, and we'll start with a new topic tomorrow. See you tomorrow.